In this video, let's take a look at new capabilities and enhancements in Simulink for modeling runtime software. You will see capabilities that support how you model, simulate, and target Simulink components for embedded software frameworks. One example of this are Simulink functions. Simulink functions have been around since release R2014B, and initially they were global in scope, so you could call them from any part of the model. Now we're introducing scoping, which helps you encapsulate components. That means that you can have Simulink functions within a subsystem closer to where they're used, and also scoped to that subsystem. If you need to call that function outside of the subsystem, you can do that too by simply using the dot notation, meaning subsystem name dot function name. And you have the option to use function connectors that show you the graphical connections between Simulink functions and their callers. If you're using model references, Simulink functions can also cross the model boundaries. So that can help you model shared resources in a reusable software component. So these scoping capabilities are helpful for promoting componentization and reuse in your designs. Another example of new and better ways to model software components are initialize, reset, and terminate functions, and state, reader, and writer blocks. And these are all important because they enable new modeling workflows. For instance, you can model functions that embedded systems use to start up and shut down, and you can customize and aggregate these functions in the generated code. And with the state, reader, and writer blocks, you simplified state setting and reading in response to initialize and terminate events. And these are all important behaviors for development of electronic control units, or ECUs. Now, let's imagine that you have to explicitly control the execution of your model components. Before 17B, the only option was to create an export function model. Starting in 17B, we introduced the ability to schedule rate-based models, which you can do with something like a state flow chart. Schedulable components give you full control over how those components in your models execute. And they give you the flexibility to easily combine different modeling styles, so export functions, rate-based styles in your models. So that's schedulable components. You may be working on systems with distributed architectures. Perhaps you're integrating software components using middleware. And components in these software compositions generate events and data asynchronously. So modeling and generating code from that message-based communication can be a challenge. So to make that challenge easier, we introduced a new library in Simulink called Messages and Events. And messages are useful because they combine events with data. And there are blocks for sending, receiving, and queuing messages. And other blocks like the sequence viewer to visualize all event activity in a model. Before, stateflow and sim events were the main ways to work with messages. Now you can tackle even more complex use cases with all these tools. Sim events is a great addition to handle things like message routing and delays between components. And stateflow is great for state management, logic, and handshaking. Keep in mind that code generation is not supported with sim events, but you still get all the value of simulation and understanding how your system behaves. And there are many examples available for this new library to help you get started. All right, we've seen new ways to model software components and new ways to simplify the integration of those software components. Now, let's talk about visualization and control. We know that we can schedule components in rate-based models with a stateflow chart. But what if you have to schedule 100 components or maybe 500 components? That's where the schedule editor is really valuable. And that is because it helps you manage that scheduling process. That means that you can now visualize in a single interface different model partitions and their relationships for execution. But more importantly, you can control and change those relationships and the order. And this is true for both export function modeling style and rate-based modeling style. There is also a sequence viewer block to help you visualize the messages and events in your models. So you see that in the y-axis, the sequence viewer shows you time. And in the x-axis, what you see is the sequence of events that are happening in the model. And you can also see the data that is transmitted through each one of these events. I mentioned that when you're modeling runtime software, you probably will end up auto-generating code from your models. And in the past, the code generators only produced column major C code. Now you have the option to generate column major or row major code. And that's valuable because depending on the algorithm, row major can improve the performance and make it easier to integrate with external code or frameworks. And as usual, there are examples to walk you through how to do this. And I will show you a really simple case. Say you want to generate code for this lookup table here. By default, you would get column major code. But we can change that with just a few clicks. So we definitely want to do this efficiently. The first thing is to make sure that the array layout setting matches the algorithm setting in the configuration parameters of the model. So under the interface pane, we select row major for the array layout. Under the math and data type optimizations pane, we check algorithms optimized for row major array layout. Then we build our model. And now you see that when we auto-generate code, we get efficient code in row major layout. And that brings us to the end of modeling runtime software. See you in the next video.